Again, ladies and gentlemen, outside there's still about 10 or 15 chairs inside if you'd like to keep coming through. I'd like to welcome you, everybody here this morning, and wish you a good morning and say thank you for being here as we've gathered today to honour, commemorate and to give thanks to the life of Tony Phillips. Today's ceremony is an essential part of the process of coming to terms with the sudden loss of Tony, and it's important that we gather here today for several reasons. We come together today to reflect on Tony's life, to take the opportunity to give thanks for the things that made him special to each of you, to share some of the stories that you made with him along the way, to begin to accept his passing and start the healing process, and to give thanks for all the wonderful memories that he's left you with. We also acknowledge the fact that there will no doubt be sadness in the room today, as is to be expected with the loss of someone so dearly loved. Tony's passing leaves a hole in the lives of all those who cared for him, and it's only natural to be experiencing grief, as you say, a final farewell in a physical sense, and begin to adjust to his absence in your lives. The grief that you're feeling today comes as a result of the love that you have for Tony. It's life's way of honouring that part that he played in your lives, and it's a measure of how much he impacted upon you. Today's ceremony is a crucial part of the grieving process, but just as crucial the days ahead, as you should remember to continue to speak Tony's name, to recall all of those beautiful memories that he's left behind with you, in so doing healing the wounds that his passing leave. It's the fact that our time on earth is finite which makes our lives and the moments that we spend with loved ones so very special. And although we can never relive those treasured moments past, their memory will continue to give warmth and brightness to the days ahead. It's important to remember that we're here today to rejoice for all of the good times of Tony's life, to laugh for all the funny times, to cry for all of the sad times, but most of all to celebrate Tony's life and remember the unique and wonderful person that he was and the years that you were lucky to share with him. Those who knew Tony would describe him as an uncomplicated man who was kind, thoughtful, who had a great sense of humour and a huge heart. He had a few passions that he filled his life with, including a love for motorbikes, and he spent many happy hours on his Harley, riding across the country, visiting remote and exotic places on adventures with his mates. And I'd just like to thank all his mates that could make that beautiful tribute this morning in leading Tony's hearse up here to the chapel today. I'm sure he'd be absolutely chuffed, and I think we certainly woke anyone up that was still sleeping. Tony was never one to sit still. He was always doing something, whether he was out washing the car or doing jobs around the house, he was always on the go. Another of his favourite pastimes was spending time in the garden, creating a beautiful paradise and letting his green thumb grow wild. And he loved coming up with ideas to expand and improve on the garden. He was a social man who was always willing to help friends and members of his community, offering support to the local men's shed. And he loved spending time in the company of his mates, enjoying a beer, a laugh, a joke, and no doubt spinning a good yarn. But of all the things that he loved in life, however, none came before his family. They meant the absolute world to him, in particular his wife Tracey, whom he adored and was devoted to. He simply lived for his family. He was always there for them, no matter what they needed. He was a loving husband, father, grandfather, and he was never happier than when he was spending times making those beautiful memories with his wife, kids, grandkids and friends, and he cherished each moment that he spent with his family. It's not only his family and his friends that feel the loss of Tony today, but the wider community that Tony has played his unique part in. Over his time on the earth, he's touched so many lives and come into contact with so many people along his journey. He's brought everyone here today, and what a beautiful tribute it is to see so many people here. He's left an everlasting impact on all those people that he came into contact with along the journey, and he's no doubt left the world a better place for having been here. And although he no longer has a physical presence in your lives, his impact and influence will continue on through the days and weeks ahead. as you continue to reflect on all of the memories that he's left behind with you, as you reflect on all that is in this world now simply because he was here. And as we say goodbye to Tony today, we do so with gratitude for the time spent with him, comforted in the knowledge that he's no longer suffering any of life's pain or sorrow. He's lived a rich and fulfilling life, and he did the things that he wanted to do while he was here. He's lived a rich life, and he's now enjoying the peace that comes at the end of a life well lived. We're going to hear some more about Tony's life today in tributes from family and close friends. I'd like to start by inviting Glenn Henry to come up and share some words.
G'day all. Thank you. Yeah, pardon me if I read this. I'm not real good at speaking at all. He was born Anthony Ross Phillips on the 7th of June 1953. We all knew him as Tony. He was my friend, the closest friend that I had here on the coast for 33 years. We were two young families who came to the Coffs Coast to settle in the summer of 88, 89, Tony and Trace lived directly opposite my then brother-in-law in Lady Belmore Drive. We became very good friends, and our wives too, and our kids were nearly the same age. Tony's son Jason, a year older than my son Ben, and his daughter Jessica, a year younger than my son Lucas. Everyone became friends. The times were good. Tony and I chartered similar careers, working on civil engineering projects wherever they happened to be, but working away from home was somewhat enduring. Tony was an earth mover and I an engineer. We both wanted to find secure work in the coast so we could enjoy watching our families grow up. Tony managed this better than I. The brother-in-law and I started a design and construct process, mainly house slabs and driveways. Tony and Trace started a bobcat business, TNT, which stood for Tony and Trace. Tony did all of the excavation work for our work. He was a genius on a bobcat and operated excavators, backhoes, dozers and scrapers as well. Tony's whole career was as an earth mover, and in 2002 he landed the dream job at Coffs Harbour City Council, where he stayed until he retired Christmas Eve last year. His father, Bill, was an earth mover, and his son, Jason, is an earth mover, three generations and counting. Bill lived long enough to see his grandson, Jason, get started in this career. Tony was so proud of Jason's achievements in the industry, as Jace is now entrusted with operating some of the biggest machines in the industry and a specialist to laser accuracy. Tony grew up in Darwin and worked in crocodile country. At a very young age, he had saved enough money and took off to America to live the dream and bike it across the USA. Wow. He came home early though, to a massive cyclone that hit Darwin that was also called Tracey. The house that his dad had built was the only house still standing in the street. What does that tell you about Tony's father's ability? Tony met Trace when Trace was only 18 years old on the Central Coast. He had everything he wanted and needed now, a Quagga 900 and a hot sword. They had two children and then they emancipated to the North Coast where our story together began. His special joy was the 88,000 kilometres he spent on his brand spanking new Harley Centenary model 2003. And Tracy's still behind him for a lot of those rides. He used simple logic to finally sell the beast. After so many kilometres, he'd been blessed to do this without serious injury. He did not want to press his luck. A few more things to tell you. Tony had an unchallengeable work ethic. Tracy had the house immaculate always, and he had the yard always manicured and the gardens, the lawns and the gardens. He even toparied the trees. His car and Tracey's car were always kept immaculate. His Harley was kept in showroom condition. His work machines were kept spotless. He even worked 3 years beyond his retirement. And then he lived for the joy of his grandkids, Ethan and Mason, both potentially little earth movers to make it four generations. I don't know how well you knew Tony, you all knew Tony, but did you know that he was a champion of the spoken word and that he was absolute crap at writing them? How can it be? Where he grew up, most people spoke Pig Latin, and Tony and his parents were very fluent. I was fortunate once to listen to he and his mother have a conversation, and it blew me away. He was able to quote facts and figures, recite poems and prose. He was very interested in politics and science. Mind you, he had no faith in politics. He was a very accomplished man, literally. I think it comes from so many years sitting in the machine and listening to the ABC News and other programs. He put me onto a good book years ago, The Mover of Men and Mountains by R.G. Latono, about a man who invented machines to move the earth, and he claimed that he only achieved it because he had a partnership with God. He also invented the machines to make those machines. None of this technology existed at the turn of the 20th century. R.G. Latono is still regarded widely today as the father of civil engineering. This is the sort of stuff that inspired Tony. Tony understood the very science of moving earth and had a lot of practice over 50 years. He was able to push machines to their limit, and this was not for the faint-hearted. It was like boys with their toys for Tony. And lastly, Tony's taught me a lesson. Make sure that you're doing what you love, because it can all be taken away from you in a glance. You'll be sadly missed, me mate.
Thanks, Glenn, for that beautiful tribute. Going to hear now from some of Tony's riding mates, and Chad Vines is going to come up with a few mates and share something with us.
We're here to celebrate the life of Tony Phillips, our Arnie. We wish to give our deepest condolences to Tracey, Jason, and Jessica, and the families. We would like to thank everyone for coming to remember and celebrate Arnie's life. We each have our own special memories, which we hold dearly in our hearts. Before I go a bit more, thanks Arnie for turning on this lovely weather for us, because by crikey, he hated riding in the rain.
Only because he got his bike.
Yeah, well, I first met Arnie when I arrived at Ace's workshop one Saturday morning many years ago, and standing just inside the doorway was Arnie. I knew from first impression he was a character and a down-to-earth person. I would often find him there on a Saturday, as long as it wasn't raining, as you couldn't get his Harley wet unless he was on one of our rides. It would take too long for him to clean it. He was very particular about his bike. It was always spotless and shining like a new bike. Arnie was a character and always up for a chat. I often caught up with him when I was visiting my stepdaughter and her husband, who lived in the same units in Jarrett Street, where you would find him washing and polishing his car or Harley until he sold it, and more often than not, was in the garden wearing jeans, even on the hottest of days, with his stubby in his hand or right next to him, enjoying gardening. I don't think the gardens at Jarrett Street will ever look as tidy and well-groomed as when Arnie was looking after them. Must have been the smell of the beer that made them grow so well. I can recall the first time I caught him in the garden wearing shorts. I said, "Nice legs, shame about the face." To which he replied, "Finally, after all these years, they've got me into shorts." Every time we met up, I was always greeted with a firm handshake and a big old man hug. He was always up for a drink and a good time, and with his dry sense of humour, we always had plenty of laughs. He was great company on all of our rides and was often the last to hit the hay and first to rise. I don't recall him ever having a bad word to say about anyone. Last of all, we would like to say to our beloved brother, you are always in our hearts and thoughts, and you will be sorely missed. And as he always said to me, pirates forever.
Just adjust it for the big people. I guess you're going to hear a few reoccurring things today. Everyone has the same type of memory with Tony, or as we like to call him, Arnie, because he did look exactly like Arnie Schwarzenegger, that is. Anyway, Arnie was a great friend for a long, long time to not only myself, but many, many others. He just had that kind of effect. But look, when somebody close passes away unexpectedly, it leaves you with a list of things that you wish you could have said and done. It kind of leaves you with a hole, you know, you start to remember stuff, but you remember the good times past, you remember all the laughs, the debates, the trying to solve the world's problems, and mostly over a beer or two or more. Arnie, as he was affectionately known, was a true great mate. We caught up often, and it was whether it was over the phone to share a joke or even gossip about some meaningless crap or whatever. But every time we had a beer together, he was always going on about his family and the grandkids. "You should see what they can do now," he would say that as he would start to proceed to give you all the details about it. I thought it was great. So he was a really proud parent and grandpa. It really did work for him. I have some fond memories from all the crazy antics we got up to, especially when we were road tripping on the motorbikes. And there was a time when we were in some place out west, and he had this grand idea for a new security system for his motorcycle. So he decided to tie a piece of string to his bike along the ground and up the wall and through the window, and then tied it to his big toe or some other extremity, because he said if they try to push his bike away, it will give him a tug. I still think they were his undies they pegged on the wall at the Daly Waters pub in the Northern Territory, but I don't know for sure. We can check on that later. Anyway, Tony was really passionate about everything he said and he did. We've all heard this a couple of times already. Everything had to be cleaned, polished, trimmed, and looked just perfect. And that also extended to his bike, car, garden, and so on. And those who know will know. I'll miss this bike, like many others will too. And he kind of just had that effect on people where you kind of expect him to be there all the time. He had a saying that he kept reminding me of always, and that was, he said, "Respect is a two-way street, mate. You've got to give it out to get it back." They are the words that I will remember the most. Farewell, brother.
loyalty, respect and honour. These are the words that describe our mate Arnie. My name is Chad and I have spent many great years riding Harleys and drinking lots and lots and lots of alcohol with him. We all met hanging around Psycho Motorcycle Shop by becoming members of the AMC. We called him Arnie. Most of his mates who rode with him didn't know his real name. Small in stature, but mighty in personality. He was so much fun to be around. We laughed and laughed with his unusual sense of humour. Our mate Dick and Arnie were tied at the hip. They rode alongside each other and had their own sign language. They argued like old married couple who weren't afraid to give each other the finger just for fun of it. Arnie would ride with no hands in the air, pretending he had ape hangers just like Dick, just to get the laugh from the boys. Arnie was a great friend who had many great qualities, but one that was outstanding was his cleanliness. He was anal, in the cleaning way. He was particular about everything, the house, his car, and mainly his motorbike, to the extent that he made us pull over on a ride because his bike was dirty, seriously. But that was why we loved him. We had many great rides over the years, but there was no doubt the Four States, One Territory on the 4th of September 2004 was a highlight for all of us, and especially for Arnie. I know this because Arnie would text me every Father's Day, every year, reminding me of the different things we got up to. Catching up with his son Jason in Darwin was a highlight of his trip. The morning we were due to meet to set off on our trip, 4:45 a.m, we were so excited and couldn't sleep, so we started to gather at Psycho from 4 a.m. Arnie was one of the first to arrive, as he had been wound up for weeks. We sat around drinking champagne and orange juice until the boys arrived. That was the good old days. For the first 7 days of the trip, it rained, and we were soaked to the bone. When the sun came out at Cooper Pedy, Arnie made us clean our bikes. This involved us drinking 60 cans of beer. Then we went to the Italian club and Arnie ran into the local priest. He got the priest to bless us on our trip and to keep us safe. It worked. We stopped for the iconic photo in front of Uluru, and this photo has become a memento of our trip. It's over there. Arnie got 200 kilometres an hour out of his diner from Coober Pedy to Alice Springs. We loved Alice Springs as we rode our bike straight into the bar at Bojangles. Bojangles was the best pub we experienced along the way. The boys lined their bikes up at the bar, filled their saddle bags with grog and took photos. We got on the road early each morning and even rounded up the highway patrol car on our way to Tennant Creek. He followed us to the pub, not to book us, but to check out our bikes and where we were headed, as he was a Harley rider himself. He wished he was on our trip. He even gave us the Tennant Creek farewell by flashing his lights and giving us a wave at the three ways on our way out. Next stop was Dally Waters. Not much to say about that. Arnie loved the pub. Arnie was the tour guide in Darwin, and he felt like a king because we stayed at the Novotel Atrium, a 5-star resort. This didn't stop us from servicing our bikes at the resort while drinking all day in the hot sun. We even parked our bikes around the pool so that wouldn't get stolen. Arnie made sure of that. I'm sure they were pleased to see the back of us. Next morning, we headed out to Jabiroo for breakfast. What a ride. Big ants' nests, big trees, big crocodile motel, and big sweeping bends. Arnie said his brain took a while for the wires to touch in the morning after a big night, so he would ride at the back of the pack. When we left Kemmerwheel, we hit the roadworks. The dirt road was narrow and wet. To avoid the road trains coming the other way, we rode single file, except for Arnie. Next thing we know, he rounds us all up, obviously unaware but now awake. He's off the road, through the scrub and back on the road again. After surviving his wild hog's adventure, it was 9 a.m. and definitely time for another beer. After the beers, the rest of the ride to Airlie Beach was superb. We hired a yacht when we got to the Whitsundays. We all had a job and Arnie's was the barbitch. I was the cook. He was a great barbitch and made sure we never went thirsty, but considering we took on 5 cartons of 30 beer cans, 3 bottles of bourbon, a large bottle of scotch and rum for 2 days, there was no chance of that happening. When we went back to Airlie Beach to grab our bikes, many of us struggled to fit back into our bike gear. Since 2004, we have sat around and shared many laughs and highlights of 4 states and 1 territory. And there's no doubt that the best thing that came out of that trip was mateship. The bonds and friendships gained cannot be diluted over the years, and I know that the trip was one of Arnie's best life experiences. Although another highlight for Arnie was the Cooley Rocks ride. Some of us took our wives and Arnie brought along Jess. Jess was only 14 or 15 at the time. Now, of course, Jess was going wherever Arnie went, so this meant we had to sneak her into Cooley Hotel. The pub was pumping, and with Jess being little and skinny, we managed to slip her in between us without the bouncers noticing. Or if they did, we got away with it that time. Sorry about that, Trace. We had another fantastic night, and I know Arnie loved hanging out with Jess that weekend. My mate Arnie was a great operator, an awesome bloke, and an honest friend. May he rest in peace. Tracy, if there is anything we can do to help you or your family, we are here for you. Thank you.
Well, Arnie, old mate, you've beat us to the last stop, and it's time for us to say farewell. There's probably a lot of people here wondering how he got the name Arnie. We were on a ride when we were in the club, I think it was the Gilgandra, and Tony and Tracy, it was their first ride with us before they joined the club. And as per usual at Gilgandra, every year the barman put on karaoke for us. So I've gone around and I'm asking people what they want to sing so I could let the DJ know. And Tony and Tracy picked out a song, I can't remember what it was now, it's a few years back. But I've written their names down and for some reason I didn't put Phillips, I put Arnold. For whatever reason, I have no idea. But anyway, Tony and Tracy were introduced up to the karaoke as Tony and Tracy Arnold. And they did sing this song very well, I've got to say. Can't remember the song, but they sang it well. And from there on, he was Arnie. So that's how he got the name Arnie. It was only by mistake, but it stuck with him and suited very well. So all I'd like to say now, Arnie, is, mate, keep the sun in your face, wind in your hair, the 2 black things facing down, and ride on to Harley Heaven, mate. Thank you.
It's incredible, 80,000 k's on a bike. So a backside sore just thinking about that. Thank you to everyone who's spoken. That's really made this tribute so much more personal. And I'd like to finish with Lucas Glenn to come up and share some words.
I didn't write anything down because I'd be here for days. But first of all, on behalf of Jess, Trace, Jace, June, and his two amazing grandkids, EJ and Mace, I just want to say thanks to everyone. Obviously, you knew what sort of a great man he was. I don't need to tell you, that's why we're all here. But he's going to be sadly missed. I miss his stories. He was a man who was just an encyclopedia full of useless crap that used to fool my kids, and they'd come home and I'd hear about the rise and fall of the Roman Empire and just all these things and how Latimer first came under vampire and make their enemies fear him and all these things that he used to fill your head with, and he was just the coolest pop. And I never really knew that I had a name. I always got introduced as, this is my a-hole of a son-in-law. Everywhere I went, and then it led on with his mongrel. But the day that I had to ring him to say, I need to know if you're going to let me marry your daughter or not, mate. He said, well, you've been with her long enough now, what do you need my permission for? I said, mate, because I'm old school and I want to know that you're okay with that. And he was, and he said to me, he said, she's yours now, mate. The last couple of times we spent with him, I mean, it was good. I'm always going to miss his little sayings, you know. Act like an a-hole, get treated like an a-hole. Show a bit of respect, get treated with respect, you know. And there's never going to be another man like him. We're never going to fill the hole. But just as long as you've all got those memories that make you smile and make you laugh, I mean, that's what he was always about. He just, someone's having a bad day and he was having a worse day, he'd make sure your day got better. And he'd just keep powering on. To have him as a father-in-law, he used to always say to me, what do you want to hang around with an old father like me, mate? And I used to say, because you're my mate. You're not just a father-in-law, and that's the thing. It's we conquered many projects over the series of houses. We had this old crappy house that me and Jay used to crab and fish and stuff at Short Street, just around the corner from where they used to live. And I think just about every job we took on, we always end up that drunk and that sick. I tell you, by the next day, it was just a horrible, horrible day, and he'd sort of look at you the next day and like, wow, man. He's just going to be sadly missed. And I just hope that you've all got those little memories of Tone that are always going to make you smile. And as he always used to say, greatest pleasure in life is doing things you should not do, but doing it with those you love. And that's the way he lived his life, and I just hope, and I'm grateful of all the blokes that turned up on their bikes today. I mean, he went out full throttle the way that he lived life and came into it. And I just got to say, I'm going to miss you, mate. Take care.
I'd just like to open up the microphone now to anyone here who might like to come up and share something. You might have prepared something, or something might just come to you as you're sitting here. So if you'd like to, now is the time for anyone here who'd like to come up and share something.
Glenn Henry spoke of how he would keep his lawn immaculate, and I'm the same age as Jess. I went to school, I was in the same class in high school as Lucas, Glenn's younger son, and I remember one particular story from Lucas bragging to another one of our mates about Tony and with his lawn, how there's not one blade of grass that's out of place. And that was true. Everyone in the street knew that. You can ask people that are here. It's really sad news to hear. Obviously, like, Tony's been a part of our family's life and we've been a part of their family's life for around 30 years now. We've all grown up and moved on and gravitated back here. It was always great to catch up with Tony the few times that I got to. When I became an adult, and to hear all the stories that pretty much just echo exactly the type of person that Tony was, it doesn't matter who you talk to, you're going to get similar stories of his character, which really just speaks volumes about who he was as a person, in the fact that he was genuine and didn't behave one way in front of one group of mates and one way in front of another. You always knew where you stood with Tony as well. And I think that's been passed on to his kids, definitely. I'm so, so sorry to the family. Like, this is a shock loss. I certainly didn't expect it. I remember the last time I was drinking with Tony, there's no way the bloke that I was talking to last time I caught up with Tony, I believed that today was coming so soon. And just want to pass my thanks on to the family for holding this, and I'll speak to everyone at wake.
Before we move on, is there anyone else here? Also outside, if anyone would like to come in and say something, you're welcome to do that.
I'm Rullis, Steve's wife. They had a great, not even friendship, it was brotherhood that they had together. They would ring each other, be in each other's lives. And when you guys, we were together, Tony shared so many stories of what they did and what they got up to. And it was a different story every time. We never, over the 20 plus years, had the same story of what they got up to. And it was a lot. But there was always that love there for each other, and they were constantly for each other and for you, Trace. And we're going to miss you heaps, but always remember those, have those memories with us. We've had some really good times together. So, yeah, love to all of you guys.
Well, we've heard a great collection of memories that have captured those special moments of Tony's life, and we're going to take some time to just stop and quietly reflect on those memories now as we watch a slideshow with some special music that's been chosen for today and some of the pictures that have captured those special moments. So I'll draw your attention to the screen now as we watch the slideshow.
Storm clouds gather and I'm losing my way. She stands right beside me. She lights up my my day. She's the one thing I found right in a world that's gone wrong. She's the words and the music to the world's finest song. Lord, let me keep her at least for a while. I promise that I love her until I walk my trumpet start sounding and you're calling me home. Don't send me no angels, 'cause I've got my gone. Don't send me no angels, 'cause I've got my own. Don't send me no angels, 'cause I've got my own.
If you had not have fallen, then I would not have found you. Angel flying too close to the ground. And I patched up your broken wing. And hung around a while. Trying to keep your spirits up. And your fever down. I knew someday that you would fly away. Love's the greatest healer to be found. So leave me if you need to. I will still remember you're flying too close to the ground. ¶¶
at the end of the slideshow there and that Lucas shared with us earlier was something that Tony always used to say, and he lived his life by it. It's printed on the front of your Order of Service booklets, and I'm sure he'd want you to take that away with you today and perhaps think about it in your own lives as you move on from here today. Tracy's chosen a beautiful poem. You'll find that also in your Order of Service. It's called The Dash by Linda Ellis, and I'm going to share it with you now on her behalf. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that they spent alive on earth, and now only those who love them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand the way that other people feel, and be less quick to anger and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? I'm sure you'll all agree from what we've heard about Tony today, he spent his dash well. Take a moment now to acknowledge Tony's religious beliefs in sharing the Lord's Prayer with you, and if you'd like to, please feel free to join with me as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Heavenly friends, we now come to the time of committal where we entrust Tony's body to its earthly keeping, and if I could ask you to please stand as we do that, if you're able to. And so now as we say goodbye to Tony, we give thanks for all of the wonderful time spent with him. We're grateful for all that he gave to his family and friends, and for the impact that he had on the lives of those he came into contact with along his journey. We give thanks for the joy he found in life's simple pleasures of riding his Harley and visiting remote and exotic places with his mates, for the many happy hours he spent in the garden creating a green paradise, for those many happy hours he spent washing his bike and keeping it in pristine condition, for the good times spent in the company of family and friends enjoying a laugh, a beer, a joke, and a tall story. We're grateful for his strength of character and determination to live life on his terms the way that he wanted to, for the morals and wisdom that he imparted to his children and grandchildren, for him always being there for anyone who needed him, and for the thoughtfulness, kindness, and love that he showed to all those he shared his life with. And most of all, we're grateful for the beautiful memories that he leaves behind in this world as a treasured family member and friend. Anthony Ross Phillips, Tony, we release you now to the next part of your journey as we commit your body to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. May your body be returned to the elements from which it was made, and your spirit live on in the hearts of those who love you. We release you now from the bonds of this life. We wish you sweet sleep and eternal happiness. And until we meet again, may you rest in peace. Amen. Would you please be seated? As we reach the end of our service now, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank each and every one of you for being here today, for contributing and playing a part in this service of honouring and celebrating Tony's life. I'd also like to invite you to join Tony's family back at the Coffs Harbour Leagues Club, just off Hogben Drive, after this service to continue sharing some of those stories and celebrating Tony's life. In a moment, we're going to play one last song. And as the music plays, I'd like to invite you to come forward after Tony's family to take some rose petals and place them on Tony's coffin as you say your own goodbyes to him before leaving the chapel. In closing, I'd like to leave you with these final words. He has achieved success, who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has enjoyed the trust of pure women, the respect of intelligent men, and the love of little children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who has never lacked appreciation for Earth's beauty or failed to express it, who has left the world better than he found it, whether by an improved poppy, a perfect poem, or a rescued soul, who has always looked for the best in others and given them the best that he had, whose life was an inspiration, his memory a benediction. And so as you leave here today, may I please encourage you to continue to speak Tony's name, to share with those around you all of those stories that you made with him, all those beautiful memories that you have of him. And in so doing, you'll be keeping his memory alive for the years to come. So once again, thank you all for being here. And if I could ask you one last time to please stand.
Aces.